Thank you very much for the introduction. Certain things I agree with, certain things I don't. For example, you said Dharmendra will sort out some ELT problems. In fact, I'm here to generate more problems, more questions. So let me begin by thanking my dear friend Ghanshyam for inviting me. And I like this acronym, ISPEL. It's very interesting. I hope you can see my slide.
Yes, sir. We can see your slide, sir.
Yeah. Okay. I'll speak a little slower, considering that some participants have some audio problem. So I'll speak a little slower. Hopefully, I'll be audible. And I also take, I must mention the stalwarts who are attending this session, Amol and Dr. Seel and Prakash. Thank you for sparing the time. I know you're not going to get anything substantial from this presentation, but in any case, thank you for attending. Let me begin with some guidelines very quickly. There is a possibility of internet problems everywhere, so don't worry. If you get disconnected, you can reconnect using the same link. I request all of you to mute your microphone when not speaking. You can ask questions using the chat feature whenever you feel like, but probably I'll be able to answer them at the end, if at all possible. And don't worry if you don't agree with everything I say. We can always discuss things later in person, one-on-one. Let me begin with some of my premises. My premises are very strong beliefs. The first premise is no one knows everything, but everyone knows something. So if you also believe in that, then you will definitely get something from this presentation. My second premise is ELT in India, English language teaching field in India, is largely traditional, conjectural, and subjective. For example, yesterday when we had a dry run with Dr. Prakash, he asked me, how can you say it is traditional, conjectural, and subjective? Now, that's a valid point. But suppose you go to a school, talk to any teacher of English, say teaching standard 7 or 8, and then you ask that person after observing his lesson, why did you carry out this particular activity? What was your aim? What did you get at the end? What did students learn? If you are going to do the same activity next time, are you going to do it in a slightly different way? So such questions are very, very rare. So largely speaking, if you ask somebody, why did you do this? That person will say, because I was taught in the same way, or because I was taught in my BA class like this, or I have been doing it for a long time like this. So mostly it is either traditional or conjectural. They think that this will help students in this way. That's why they do it. And very often it is subjective. There is very, very rare classroom research and reflective teaching. So today's presentation might generate a couple of thousand questions in your mind, not just one or two. And hopefully the end result will be good. And my friend Amol, who is a real expert in this particular field, continuing professional development. Now, I often keep telling this, that it is a personal choice in India. For example, today, those who are attending today's session, you know that you are not going to get a certificate. This session is not going to directly help you in your promotion, no credits, nothing, no advantages, but still you are here. Why? Because you are interested in your personal and professional development. It is a matter of choice. So I must congratulate all of you on that. It's not common. So Prakash, whatever I say today, that is directly or indirectly going to help all the participants in their CPD, continuing professional development. Now, the very first question that may come to your mind when you see the title that you have seen is ELT Conundrums. But in fact, before that, I put the title ELT Myths. But when I started working on my presentation, after some thoughts, I realized that myths is not the perfect word for what I am going to share during my presentation. So myth is usually, as you know, it's a commonly believed thing, but it is a false idea, or it is not possible to check it. Whereas conundrum is a problem that is difficult to deal with, but still you can work on it. You can analyze, you can improve the situation. So I believe most of the topics that I'm going to discuss, they are based on conundrums, problems, difficult to deal with. And together, we have to try to find answers. A little deeper into the two words, myths and conundrums. Like, myths are stories, right? They have no basis in reality. And we keep telling them to ourselves, right? And we start believing them as truths. Now, if you whatever I say, you think about your ELT situation, your own classroom teaching or your colleagues' classroom teaching, and try to apply these things in those situations. Now, my point is, let's analyze our myths. And analyzing myths is often discomforting. It generates many conundrums. You will have 100 questions if you start analyzing a simple myth. And thinking about them itself gives you a wider perspective of the field. And the end result is you become more receptive, more competent, and more enlightened ELT professional. So with that background, a few caveats I must present before I go ahead, because I have only 5 decades of experience as a language learner and only probably 3 decades of experience as an English language teacher, which is a very small time period compared to the entire field of English language teaching. And another thing is, most of my teaching is limited to learners whose first language is either Gujarati, Hindi or Marathi. But I believe the things that I discuss will be applicable to most first languages in India. And thirdly, my 1/3 of career has been in the informal sector. And almost, I believe, 90% of you are from the formal sector. So there are a few things which you may not be able to do because of the constraints of the formal sector. Now, we'll take myths one by one. And now, if you ask me, or if some student asks you, what is easy? Is it grammar? Is it pronunciation? Is it vocabulary? What is easy? Now let's take each item one by one. You know that in grammar, there are so many complex things. For example, the simple present tense. Number one, it is not used always for the present time, and it is not always simple, right? It is used for more than 10, 15 situations. For example, when you say, I promise to pay you so and so, such and such amount. So it's the present time. When you talk about some past historical story kind of thing, then you might use the simple present tense. Even mythological stories, you use the simple present tense, but actually you are referring to a past time event. You might use it for the future time. For example, if he comes tomorrow, I will help him. So here you are using the same tense, simple present tense, for future. Similarly, simple past tense. It's not always for the past. can be for present. I wish I knew. Suppose you ask me a difficult question, I just have to say, I wish I knew the answer. So here, I'm talking about the present time. It can be for future also, right? Present continuous tense, not always used for present time and not always used for a continuous action. I'm meeting my friends tomorrow evening, future time. The subjunctive mood, so complicated, difficult. Our logical mind will find it very difficult to understand. So grammar, let's take it for granted, grammar is not easy. Let's move to pronunciation. Dr. C.L.N. Prakash's favorite topic. Start from the very first letter A and you will have problems. You, in the sense, your students. The letter A in isolation is spoken as A, but in a word, it can be A as in apple, A as in ability, O as in all, A as in ask, A as in able, A as in any, and air, even a diphthong, area. So one letter, one sound is not the case in English. English is not a phonetic language. Now, all Indian languages are phonetic. The letter and the sound, they're always the same. So pronunciation is a big problem for our learners. Take another letter, T, teacher, th, nature, ch, nation, sh, and listening disappears altogether. In Indian languages, do we have silent letters? I don't think we have. The letter U, A as in cup, U as in put, unique, U as in unique, and berry. How on earth can one imagine the pronunciation of a word? So English is difficult, pronunciation is terrible. Not enough, even word stress. If you take conduct, it has one meaning, it's a noun, behavior. And if you say conduct, it's a verb. Similarly, content, what are the contents of this bottle? So it's a noun, and I'm content with what I have. So it's an adjective. Sometimes I ask my teacher friends, are you content with your content? Now, if they don't know this particular feature of English, they'll just stare at you. Right? One step further, what about words having similar spellings? Like tear and tear. Same spellings, different pronunciations, different meanings. If you tear my page, I'll have tears in my eyes. What about homophones, similar sounds? Have you seen that scene? And one step further, what about rhythm and intonation? So let's accept that English is not easy. Grammar is difficult, vocabulary is difficult. Now let's pronunciation is difficult. Now let's move to vocabulary. Now suppose you are a logical student, you have an analytical bent of mind, like a science student. I'm also a science student, by the way. Appropriate and inappropriate, by adding in prefix, you are converting it into an opposite word. Ability and inability, opposite. But what about flammable and inflammable? Now they are the same. So by adding a prefix in certain words, you convert them into opposite. In certain other words, they are the same. Valuable, invaluable, same. Switch on, opposite switch off, fine, no problem. But what about put on? Put on an opposite, take off. You put on a shirt, you take off your shirt. And put off has a different meaning. You put off means you postpone something, right? Let's take another feature of English. From one word, when you make other words, like horror and terror, they are similar in many ways. From these two words, you form words, adjectives, horrible and horrific. They are the same. sorry. And then you try to make similar words from terror, terrible, and terrific. They are not the same. Terrible is negative, and terrific is extremely positive. So by mistake, if you say, oh, you look terrible today, in place of terrific, you'll be in trouble. Again, if you're a logical person, a logical learner, from sing, we have singer, play, player, tease, teacher. But from cook, can you say, my wife or my sister, she's a good cooker? No. She's a good cook, that's it. From pickpocket, we can't make pickpocketer, right? So one thing is clear, that English is not easy. So we shouldn't, to my mind, we shouldn't give false hopes to students by saying English is easy, anyone can learn it. No, it's difficult, it takes time. It demands a lot of effort on learner's part and on teacher's part. Now let's take another situation. Statement. Communicative language teaching. And many people boldly make statements like this. Communicative language teaching is the best method to teach English. In fact, I was also one of the few people advocating CLT, say 15, 20 years ago. We used to have regular workshops and seminars for teachers of English when CLT was introduced in Gujarat textbooks. Now, honestly speaking, each method has its own pros and cons. I have personally met so many teachers in far away, in remote rural areas. They themselves have studied via pure, pakka, unadulterated grammar translation method, and they are excellent at English. Some who have studied via structural method, for example, those who were in students in 70s and 80s, they had textbooks based on structural method. Some of them are excellent users of English. So each method has its pros and cons. We can't say one method is the best. It always depends on the situation and the abilities of teachers. So CLT, I'm not against CLT. Communicative language teaching, definitely in most language teaching in the world today, CLT is used. But it is not a panacea for all our Indian ELT problems. Now, why do I say that? Because CLT is a very, very demanding method, and demanding on the part of the teacher. If a teacher wants to use CLT in the true sense of the term, then that person should have a rich, flexible, and varied command of the English language. That's the primary requirement. Everything else will fail if this requirement is not met. And that person should be a normal, natural, fluent, spontaneous speaker of English. The teacher should be good at exploiting situations arising in class. Like, I'm sure you will agree with me that everything that the teacher does in the classroom has a direct impact on learners' learning, basically, right? So for example, if you are in a classroom and you ask a question, and 10, 15 students, they want to answer the question. They say, yes, sir, 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 teacher, teacher. Now that's a situation. Now, if you are able to exploit the situation and teach some English indirectly, then you can be a very good CLT teacher. You can say, hold your horses, hold your horses. Now, because of the context, students will be able to understand. Then classroom management, CLT demands a lot of skills, because in CLT, you will have to give a lot of tasks, a lot of activities, pair work, group work. So at that time, classroom management plays a very important role. CLT also demands a lot of knowledge of the world and people. And also learning styles. Different learners have different learning styles. It's now common knowledge. So accordingly, the teacher should devise activities, plan classroom session. Now the seventh last point I added, this was the last point I added, because many teachers who are really good at English, who really want to implement CLT in their classrooms, but they might not have sufficient time to prepare and teach and then assess. So it demands a lot of time, basically. Now the next point, many teachers, they tell students, think in English. Now this is a very difficult piece of advice. For example, if somebody tells me to think in English now, I will find it extremely difficult to consciously do it, right? This is a very complex area in neuroscience and neuro, I don't know what it is, psycholinguistics or whatever it is. It's so complex. We don't know in what language we think. I have been studying this language and thought related material for the last probably 3-4 months. And I don't know in what language we think. So if you give it as a piece of advice to students, and if some student asks you, how is it possible? Then you don't have an answer. But what you can do is, you can tell the student that when somebody drives a car, at that time, he might be talking on the phone also, he might be listening to music, that person will change gears and increase the speed, decrease the speed. Now, all these things are done automatically. The person who drives doesn't have to consciously think about it, right? It becomes automatic. So what probably we can do is, we can increase automaticity in language use. So what is that? Automaticity is the ability to do things without occupying the mind with the low level details required. For example, collocation, word partnership. Now, if you know that make and mistake, they go together, your brain will not have to think, your mind will not have to, you know, stop there and analyze and then say, no, make a mistake, the whole thing comes automatically. That means the more such combinations you have, the better will be your fluency, right? So the more the automaticity, the better is the command of language. Now, how is it possible to acquire in our case in ELT? So it is usually the result of, the last line is very important here. I don't know whether you can see my cursor. So it is usually the result of learning, that means acquiring knowledge about that particular topic, repetition and practice, right? Use. Now, still, if you are not convinced how to do that, then let me give you a few activities that may promote automaticity. First is, we can tell students to flood themselves with English via listening and reading. And at the same time, it is advisable to tell listeners what to listen to and what to read, because, you know, sometimes the wrong choice of material might be demotivating. I remember one of the, I think I shared it in one of the seminars recently, a student of mine, he came to me, he said, my teacher asked me to read something very substantial. So I asked her what to read, and she said, you read Pride and Prejudice by Jane Austen. So I said, fine, what happened then? That student said that after 2 pages, I couldn't go further. 2 pages were enough to kill my interest in reading. Now, on analyzing, I found out that that person did not have enough language to read that novel. It's a heavy reading, difficult. So what students read and listen to, that, you know, the teacher has to guide that student. Then practice both active and passive listening. Passive listening means you just keep the material on, the audio on, even if you're doing some other work. Now, why is it important? Because if you think about your own first language acquisition, how did you acquire the first language? You did not learn it, you acquired it, just picked it up. So during your childhood, people around you spoke that particular language. You are not paying attention to that language, but you just kept on passively listening to that. And a day came when you started using the language. So it's a gradual process. That thing normally doesn't happen in English language study in our students. Then this is something which I carry out in my classroom. I ask students to make a list of things that they come across, objects that they see, they encounter. Then another step, I tell them to go one step further. For example, suppose some student comes and says, I saw a kettle, right? A teapot. So I say, fine, now what is this called? What is that called? So then that person realizes, yes, it is not enough to know the whole name. You should also know the parts of it. So a kettle might have a spout. It might have, on the top, there may be an air nozzle. There may be a knob to lift it. There may be a lid. There may be a handle. There may be like belly and shoulder. It may have a base. So when you know the parts of things around you, that can also generate, or it can make that automaticity possible. Then another interesting thing, this is not my idea, it has been there for ever. Ask students to describe things that they don't know the words for. And one of the linguists, I don't remember, somebody might help me later, but one of the linguists has gone to the extent of saying that if you are a language learner, second or foreign language learner, and if you forget the word for hair, then you are allowed to use, in the heat of the moment, you can say grass on head to convey the message, and people will understand, right? Though it is a little far-fetched, but if you don't have the word, if you forget the word, for example, you can't stop there. You have to continue. So you can describe, right? Then small talk. Now, small talk is the kind of discussion that you carry out. You ask questions, you answer questions. For example, you are at a railway station or at an airport, and there are people around you, and you start talking with them, you ask questions, they ask questions, you answer their questions. So this is small talk. That can also generate automaticity or develop automaticity. And collocations, I have just mentioned, we have to teach students how to notice and record, store, and use collocations. It's a major, major area for automaticity. An intensive mouth practice. You know, very often our learners, they are taught a lot of language, grammar, vocabulary, pronunciation. So finally, they may be able to understand the language. But if they are not trained, if their mouth is not trained to speak, then also that automaticity will be hampered. And you can ask them to present their views on a diverse range of topics. So these are certain things that might promote what we in abstract terms call thinking in English. Next is a controversial area, the use of the mother tongue. Now, most people have very strong ideas, very strong premises. They are not going to change, I know. Whether the mother tongue helps or hinders, they are sure they have made a decision. But I would like you to ask a few questions to yourself and then come to a conclusion. For example, why should we use the mother tongue? If you are convinced, if you think that it is going to help learners, go ahead. But first of all, think about it. Who does it help? Does it help you or your learners? Is it a matter of choice that you are using your mother tongue or student's mother tongue, or is it because you don't have enough language and that's why you use it as a linguistic crutch? So you should be very clear about that. Then who will use the mother tongue? Whether it is between students, or students when they talk to teachers, or the teacher while explaining to students, who will use it? And how much percentage? For example, if you have 45-minute, 50-minute period, then how much time will you use or anyone use the mother tongue? And in what situations? While giving instructions, while explaining? And does it end? Suppose you start using the mother tongue, but how long will you continue? Will it ever end, and when? Next point is marks and degrees. They reflect one's ability in English. Now, I'm sure most of you will agree with me that degrees are often deceptive. And in the same way, the marks that we get or give, they are often deceptive. Now, the question is, when you give marks, what is measured? I know many of you do not agree with the things going on in your own formal setup, but you don't have a say. You have to accept it. I know that. But just for a moment, think, what is measured? When you give marks, say 45 marks, 50 marks to somebody, what do you actually measure? Do you measure the competence? And this competence is not that Chomsky's innate ability, as Dr. Prakash was saying yesterday. It's not the innate ability, that abstract competence. I'm talking about the basic ability to do certain things in a language. So do you check that competence, or do you check the application of that knowledge? That is performance. Then do you check, if you say it is competence that we check, is it the linguistic competence or communicative competence? I am sure you have heard about Dalhousie's four criteria for communicative competence. If you are not familiar, please read that that paper on communicative competence by Dalhousie, I think 72-73, from which actually we have this communicative language teaching. It's a very powerful and a very interesting read. Then do you measure skill or memory? Because even today there are so many question papers that I come across in our field, and they are purely based on memory. Who did what? So these are some of the questions about the competence, marks and degrees. The next is again a debatable, controversial topic. Some teachers, they say we should teach Indian English. Now, I'm sure it's a very difficult question to answer, but I want you to ask a few questions to yourself first of all. What is your preference as a teacher? For yourself as well as for your learners. Is it RP, the standard British variety of English, which is sometimes called Oxbridge English or King's English or Queen's English, or the kind of English which is as given as a model in dictionaries as the UK version, right? The recommended UK version. So do you want to keep that a kind of old BBC English as a model? Or do you prefer GA, General American English, or the recent entrant Australian English, or the Indian English? Now suppose you say Indian English, then what variety of Indian English? Because we have in Surat itself, it's a small town, Surat in Gujarat. Now in Surat, if you go to six different areas, you will have six different varieties of English. Now think about Gujarat and think about the whole country, India. So what particular variety of English will you take as a model if you say Indian English? And I believe that it's a very unfortunate situation that despite having millions of users of English in India, we don't have a recognized, recorded Indian variety of English. I hope someday it will happen. In fact, I remember when I was at CIFL, Hyderabad, now it is FLU. So at that time, people were talking about general Indian English, and there were books prepared by, I forget the name, so spoken English in India. That was the book, right? So that has not yet been really used, unfortunately. Dr. A.K. Bansal, huh? Dr. A.K. Bansal's book, he tried a lot to promote the refined Indian variety of English. And what about international intelligibility? For example, as a language teacher, you might feel that we have to go for Indian English only, but your students in the future, they might have to work in any international situation. In fact, right now in Surat, in my place, there are so many people who are doing business with international clients. So by your personal choice, if you stick to Indian English, you are doing disservice to your students. And where to get material from if you select a particular variety? What about teacher training? What about assessment? All these are questions related to model. Now, one of the statements which summarizes many people's views in our field, that's why I've written this person's statement. Learning to speak like a native speaker can be unnecessary, unrealistic, and harmful for the learner. Okay, fine. Theoretically, I accept that. But what when your learner speaks English and others don't understand? What is the point? What about unilateral idiomaticity? And another important point is there is a concept of good English. Whether you like it or not, it is there in society. People accept certain kinds of speech as good English and certain kinds of English as not so good English. It is there, whether you like it or not. And that's the reason most celebrities in India, for example, they try to speak a particular kind of English which is very close to the RP, the standard British variety of English. So I guess there are so many such points, so I will not be able to spend time on every point, but let me just show you a couple of points on the slide on the screen, and after that, if there are any questions, we can discuss. As teachers, we often have such conundrums. Should I focus on fluency or accuracy, and how? That's another area, and how to measure. And sometimes teachers advise students to read newspapers, read classics. Does it really work? How does it work? I remember one of my teachers who said every day look up in a dictionary, take any random page, see any particular word, look it up in a dictionary, you try to memorize the meanings and the sentence if there is any, and remember like that 10 words a day, and like that if you continue in 365 days you will have 3650 words. Does it really work? It hasn't worked for me, at least. The point is, when you give any suggestion to any learner, then please think before you speak. Classified vocabulary. You have lists and lists and lists and lists. Does it help? In what way? Drilling. During structural teaching and audio-lingual method, there were so many drills. Does it help? In what way? Some people say, because I don't have any partner, I can't learn English. Some people blame even the environment, because I know some of my students, they say, because I live in Surat, I can't speak English. I said, so what? You have to create your own environment. You have to learn how to create your own environment. So how can teachers help in that? Then medium of instruction. Very often, this is, in fact, in this new education policy 2020, bilingual and multilingual instruction is encouraged in a way. So what should be the medium of instruction? In Bangalore, I don't know whether my friend Ravinarayan is here. So he was saying that in many schools, they have now bilingual method official. Now we have to wait and see how the results are. In fact, one of his recent articles posted on Facebook that generated a lot of questions in that bilingual method in India. So the list is endless, right? But my goal today was to make you think about what you say and do in your classroom. These are some of the books I have used. I will send you the list via Ghanshyam later on if you want. I've used these books again and again, not just for this presentation, but my premise is my ELT background is based on some of these books. Right? It's a small collection. So thank you very much for listening to me so patiently. And now if you have any questions, I can try. I guarantee I will listen to all your questions, but I cannot guarantee I will listen. I will be able to answer all your questions. As you know, ELT is full of conundrums, right? Yeah, over to you, Ghanshyam.